I work in the science division at the Department of Fish and Wildlife in the molecular genetics lab. So if you have really deep questions about management, I might not be able to answer them because I don't work in that realm. But we provide information to the people who do the management, make the management decisions. We try to let them, give them stuff that they can use that's based on, data, information that they can use to, kind of fine-tune management. So I'm going to talk about some work we've done looking at the, stock composition in the coastal fisheries, the troll fisheries off Washington coast. So the fisheries are managed under the, auspices of the Pacific Fishery Management Council. They set the seasons, and they have a complex model that they use to, decide what to do, you know, what the impacts of different regulatory mechanisms might be. And we provide sort of an independent check on how well the models are working. So I'm going to talk about two studies we've done. One of them we published in Fisheries Magazine in February with colleagues from NOAA Fisheries in, Seattle and the Washington Trawlers Association. And then I'll talk about a similar study we did. This study was, looking at samples that were collected on board the trawlers. So we have a, another study that I'm going to throw in some information from, where we looked at samples that were taken in the ports when the fish were delivered as they crossed the dock. So we thought we might get a, different mix of, fish. We're looking at the whole fleet rather than the people who volunteered to, provide samples. So I need to acknowledge our sources of funding, the dockside samples, the, ones that we collected in the ports. Of course, that work was supported with Salt and Stall Kennedy grant money, and also Washington State General Fund supports our lab. And then the NOAA Cooperative Research Fund supported the at-sea sampling analysis that we're doing. I want to talk and thank my co-authors, Mitch Kistler in our molecular genetics lab, Paul Moran and Larry LaVoy at NOAA, and Joe Daisy at the Washington Trawlers Association. And then we have a lot of help from people, Cheryl Dean, Doug Millward, Mark Balzel, all with the Washington Department of Fish, Fish and Wildlife. And Todd Siemens, Mike Ford, Jeff Hard, Jim Myers, Gary Wynans, and John Carey, they're all now with, well, except for Todd Siemens, all of those are, those folks are with NOAA now, and they provided helpful comments on the analyses. So I'm going to talk just very briefly about relevant aspects of Chinook salmon biology, things that if you wandered in and you've never heard of Chinook salmon, it might help you understand what I'm talking about. Talk briefly about Washington ocean salmon fishery management. A little bit of discussion of the technological and scientific tools that we use. And then I'll get into the nitty-gritty of the analyses of the fisheries. So, of course, I think probably you all know that, Chinook salmon, they're anadromous like the other Pacific salmon species. And Chinook salmon, some of the, juveniles leave as sub-yearlings, some leave as yearlings, but they migrate out to the sea and return to freshwater after 2 to 5 years generally of growth in the ocean. All of the stuff I say, I use a lot of qualifiers, generally, usually, because there's a lot of variation. And there's exceptions to almost everything you can say. So, of course, salmon, Pacific salmon are famous for their fidelity to their natal streams when they return to, spawn. But that's not an absolute. The populations tend to be largely reproductively isolated because they do return to these natal streams generation after generation. And that natal fidelity and reproductive isolation can lead to local adaptation. So populations of different streams become kind of fine-tuned to their environment. So it's kind of difficult to see the color here, but this slide is to show you that, oops, really?
The middle one's the pointer.
The middle one? So on this side, we have spring Chinook spawning distributions in Washington State. And you can see they travel up the Columbia River. We have a few spring stocks in Puget Sound and out on the coast. But they tend to go up into the upper watersheds. The summer Chinook, and these are the seasonal designations refer to the time of year that they generally enter fresh water coming up from the ocean. So the summer Chinook, they're more restricted summer populations. You can see that we don't have as many lines on the map, but they also tend to migrate upper, a little higher in the watershed. The fall Chinook, a lot of them are spawning in lower in these watersheds than the spring Chinook. And so there are different habitats where all these populations are migrating to spawn. So the local adaptation kind of fine-tunes the population, so they come out of the gravel at the right time, and they hit the ocean at the right time, that sort of thing. So the marine migrations of these populations, generally the Chinook salmon follow the continental shelf as they come out. Some of them end up going south, but a lot of them go up to the north. So Wells Hatchery summer, you can see that they're distributed kind of all up and down the coast, but the bulk of the encounters that we have are up in the Gulf of Alaska, Southeast Alaska, British Columbia, that area. White Horse Pond, that's in the Stillaguamish drainage, and you can see there's a lot of encounters, Puget Sound and off the west coast of Vancouver Island, and a few up in Southeast Alaska. The Spring Creek Hatchery Thule Fall Chinook, you can see that at least for the records that I pulled up, most of the encounters that we see in the ocean are off the west coast of Vancouver Island or off Washington coast. So there's diversity in where these fish go in the ocean. And of course, Chinook salmon have a lot of value for the citizens of the state. The tribal fisheries, Salado Falls is famous, a lot of tribal use, ceremonial subsistence and some commercial. And of course we have the all citizens commercial fishery and recreational fisheries. So looking at how these fisheries developed, in the late 1800s, canning and large-scale processing kind of boosted the economics of Pacific salmon fishing, opened up opportunities for people to make a lot of money. By the early 1900s, people started fishing off the coast, and it was unregulated. It was out past the state or federal jurisdiction out there. And so it was pretty much unregulated. They were fishing on multiple age classes and stock mixtures that were unknown. And we really didn't even understand a lot of basic facts of Chinook salmon biology. So we didn't know about stocks of fish and that sort of thing back then. Or I shouldn't say we, I wasn't really around. But so in the 1920s, between the 1920s and 1940s, there were a lot of advances made figuring out that fish that were tagged out in the ocean, they, in one spot, they tended to disperse to a bunch of different spawning streams. So we started to get the idea that there were these different populations. In 1976, the Magnuson-Stevens Act established the Pacific Fishery Management Council, and they had, they're one of several regional management councils throughout the country that oversee federal management of fish resources. In 1978, Canada and the U.S. finally established exclusive economic zones up to 200 miles offshore, so federal jurisdiction extended out beyond where our fisheries are taking place. And that gave the federal government and the states a say in how these fishing seasons were structured. So in the 1980s, the Pacific Fishery Management Council developed a set of rules and did a lot of work trying to figure out how to manage the fisheries. Finally, in the 90s, well, in the 80s, Pacific Fishery Management Council developed some models to try to incorporate a lot of the complexity of salmon biology and migration droughts and exploitation rates in fisheries and come up with a way to kind of set seasons, project what was going to happen. And in 1998, they came up with a fishery regulation assessment model that was developed to help the council project what was going to happen in different fishery scenarios. Some of the technological and scientific developments that have come along that have helped us out quite a bit, I'm going to talk about ways that we can identify fish, the source of fish when we encounter them in the ocean, and probably the most important development that's come along for managing fisheries has been the development of the code wire tag. It was developed by the Department of Fisheries, I believe, in the 1960s, but came into large-scale use in Chinook salmon management in the 1970s. They're tiny tags. They're a quarter of a millimeter by 1.1 millimeter. And you can see they've got a numeric code that identifies either a tag group or, in some cases, they have individual tag, code numbers for individual fish. But the work that we're talking about, they have codes that identify release groups of fish. These code wire tags have to be injected into the fish to mark individual fish. So if a hatchery is releasing 200,000 marked fish, every one of those has to be marked with the code wire tag. The tags give us the ability to track the distribution of the tag cohorts across years. So when they go out to sea, they spend 2 to 5 years out there, we can see where they are at different stages in their life cycle. One of the shortcomings of the program is that it's really hard to tag wild Chinook populations. So very few wild Chinook populations are tagged. And so the hatcheries have to serve as surrogates for the wild populations. And the recoveries provide the data inputs for fisheries models. So I'm going to go through just the distribution of some tag groups to show you kind of what we see. This is a Whitehorse Pond tag group. Through year 2011, they were recovered 2013, 2014, 2015, 2016. You can see that they were recovered for 3 years by Alaska Department of Fish and Game up in here. Department of Fisheries Oceans, they were recovered for 3 years. A lot of the recoveries that are listed here, there's 311. There are a lot of them that are actually recovered on the hatchery or on spawning grounds. So this doesn't really reflect the magnitude of the spawning or the fishery recoveries. Don't get distracted by this points thing here. I would get distracted just seeing these, wonder how many different places they were found. And I just put that up there for myself to tell me that they were recovered in 100 different locations. This is an interesting thing to notice here. There are fish that kind of behave differently. And there was a tag recovered off the California coast, this group. So with that explanation in mind, the Wells Summer Chinook, you can see that they're mostly a northerly migrating stock. There were some fish caught up in a couple locations off Kodiak, Alaska, Lower Cook Inlet at Anchor Point, and Prince William Sound, but the bulk of the recoveries are in Southeast Alaska, West Coast Vancouver Island, and then off the Washington coast. Lyons Ferry, Hatchery Fall, pretty much the same kind of thing. We've got some southern environments, but mostly up to the north. The Salmon River, this is a tributary to the Sandy River, I believe, on the Oregon side of the Columbia. And get some fish out here in the Gulf of Alaska going out along the chain. But for the most part, a lot of these distributions are looking the same. You can see that there's a lot of Chinook stocks that are mixing in this area. And it creates problems for people who are trying to manage the fisheries and conserve specific stocks. And how do you do that? This is the only coastal Chinook stock with tag recoveries that I could find in the period that I was looking at. But you can see that, again, basically northerly migrating. And so you can imagine when you have a bunch of fish, let's go back here. Andy mentioned in the previous talk that these fish, you know, from Washington are encountered all up and down the coast. So the troll fisheries up in Southeast Alaska, down the Queen Charlotte Islands, and down off the west coast of Vancouver Island. They're catching fish from all these different populations that have gone up into the Gulf of Alaska and are migrating back down to spawning areas in Washington. So when people go out and catch fish in these fisheries, it's kind of a mixed bag where they came from. So all of that information I was showing you, those were recoveries of code wire tags. Another technological development, scientific development, the one that I work with is biochemical genetic marks. So these are genetic variation. In the early days, we used variant forms of proteins or allozymes. We've switched to looking at DNA variation. And we can measure a lot more variation in populations by looking at the whole genome rather than just the little section that's creating the template for the proteins that we're able to study. So opening up the whole genome is really a big deal. But the genetic marks were first applied to Chinook salmon management in the late 70s by National Oceanic Atmospheric Association, developed up at the Montlake Lab by Fred Utter and David Teal, George Milner, and the marks are persistent, naturally occurring genetic variation. So when I say they're persistent, the marks last over generations. You don't have to tag fish, they inherit the marks from their parents. And if the populations are large enough, then the frequencies of these marks in the populations aren't going to change over the years. So we can go out and we can sample a population in 1 year or 2 years, and the information we get from that exercise will kind of guide us and give us the ability to look at the distribution of that population for many years until something happens to disrupt that population. Like if it crashes or something. The genotypes of the fish that we catch in the fishery, they're probabilistically identified to source population. That means it requires a reference data set, and that's when we go out and we collect samples from all these different populations to characterize their genetic fingerprints. Importantly, all natural and hatchery origin fish carry biochemical genetic marks. It's imprinted in biology of the animals. Genetic marks in use today, though, do not explicitly encode covalents. So remember, with code wire tags, we knew what the brood year was for a tag group, and we could follow that brood year when that when a fish with that tag code is recovered, we know how old it was, or how old it is, and we know, you know, exactly where it was produced. The genetic identification is a probabilistic thing. It's pretty good, but it's not like we can look at a single fish and absolutely know exactly where it came from. The third set of technological and scientific developments that's important, and I just have to talk about a little bit about that. I'm not going to go, I can't go into the complexity of some of these models, but the advances in computing power have allowed us to create these very complex models. And so this fishery regulation assessment model, or FRAM, it's a pretty complex model. It integrates codeware tag groups from hatcheries up and down the coast. The historical data goes back into the 70s. And it looks at encounters in different fisheries historically and compares current encounters to that. It's a pretty complex model. So it's based on data from codeware tag recoveries, and it's used to project the fishery impacts of different regulatory regimes. So it integrates information across fisheries coastwide. Genetics, we use genetic stock identification, or alternatively called genetic mixture analysis. We collect fish from the fishery, compare their genotypes with a reference data set or a baseline, that's the data from all the contributing populations. We can identify natural and hatchery sources of those fish when we encounter them in mixtures. The genetic baseline that we used in the study that we're doing here includes 239 populations, and you can see they're distributed from California through Oregon, Washington, Idaho, British Columbia, and Alaska. So we have very good population coverage, and it covers all of the major contributing populations, we believe. So I think we've talked about this pretty much. One of the things to note about both these methods of looking at catches of fisheries is that the FRAM works best with populations that were codeware tagged during the early days when they were setting up the model, when they were constructing the model. And the same is true with genetic stock identification, but perhaps to a lesser degree. GSI assumes that we have all the major contributing population groups in our baseline. Now, one of the benefits of genetic stock identification is that populations that spawn close to each other, they tend to fish do stray a little bit, and so we tend to see that close neighbors are more similar genetically than more distant neighbors. So we can, if we don't have a particular population in the baseline, we're probably going to put it in the right area anyway when we do our analyses. With the codeware tag, you know that the agency that the tag it, I think, and perhaps, well, I'm not going to say anything more about that because I don't really know how those codes are assigned. So, FRAM and GSI do different things. FRAM is basically used as a planning tool for the Pacific Fishery Management Council as they're setting up their seasons. It also is used to kind of do a mop-up at the end of the season and see how well they did. But it's based on, well, until recently, it was based on codeware tag recoveries back in the late 70s, early 80s. So back in the 70s, there were a lot of tagged populations, and the fisheries were pretty wide open, so they had a lot of data. And they could look at where these tags were recovered in all these different fisheries and kind of make inferences about where fish were, what time in their life cycle, and that sort of thing. And so, up until very recently, all of the FRAM where it was based, it's done based around this base period and with some periodic revisions, as the people who were working on the model saw that they could make improvements. But it was, this base period is very important. It's just very recently been updated to include the period 2007 to 2013. And that's a period that we've covered in our dockside sampling. The CRAM is basically for modeling. GSI actually analyzes counter deficient. Yes?
You got a question on that, on your 79 series, 2 CRAM based on 707 to 2013. What has been, did they correlate the same? Because you had, at that original time, was 259 marked stocks.
Yeah.
When a lot of those, you know, we don't have anymore because we couldn't release them. So how does that correlate? Did it come back to where they were looking halfway to people?
You know, I can't tell you how the CRAM base period update, I can't tell you the particulars about that. I can tell you that they incorporated some of the information we were able to give them from our GSI, because we were able to identify some stocks that were missing from the CRAM base period. But I'm not really qualified to tell you exactly what that new base period looks like. So the GSI, as I said, we actually look at samples from a fishery and we're estimating the composition of that fishery. We're not trying to project what's going to happen, you know, during the summer or the fall or whatever. And so FRAM is sort of the basis for the Pacific, the council's season setting. And GSI can help inform the people who use FRAM about what some of the shortcomings might be. None of these systems are perfect. They're all constantly being refined. So we use GSI to analyze fisheries in the marine areas 2 through 4, Chinook landings off the Washington coast. As I said, 2012 to 2015 samples were collected by trawlers at sea. The capture locations were recorded as GPS waypoints, and we had 1,200 to 1,400 samples analyzed per year. The dockside work that I'm going to talk about, the samples were from recreational charter, commercial troll landing. We had several hundred up to over 2,000 troll samples. The numbers of recreational samples were pretty low, pretty hard to get, but they are what they are. The GPS locations that we got from the at-sea sampling show that Area 2, below this line, roughly below the line, fish were kind of spread out up and down Area 2. The Area 3-4 distribution, we combined the two areas because Area 4 and Area 3, they're basically, oftentimes they can see each other, I understand. But they're basically fishing on, it looks like the same aggregation of fish up here. So when we did the analysis of the at-sea collected samples, across the bottom here we have the name of the FRAM stock, or stock group. On this side we have the proportion of the harvest that we estimate came from each of these groups. And so the taller bars here they represent a higher proportion of the total landings that came from this stock, in this case the mid-Columbia tules in 2015. We have one non-FRAM stock included here. The rest of the non-FRAM stocks are included over here. This stock, the mid-Oregon coast stock, it was It was an important consideration, I think, in revising the base period, because our analyses showed that, this is over several years, that we are catching substantial numbers of mid-Oregon coastal Chinook that the model didn't cover. And the reason it didn't cover it is because it didn't have any tags back in the 70s from that area, or not very many. But when we went back and looked at the data after we started